liberty, and justice for all.
Okay. Again, welcome to the planning board meeting. Just for your information, these meetings are televised and recorded on YouTube. So, roll call, we are all present and accounted for. Public comment, is there any public comment not relating to agenda items for tonight? Seeing none, we'll move on to the minutes approval. 3/13/17, were there any comments, concerns, questions?
Nope.
Okay, we will sign those. And then the 3/13/17, 274 Prospect Street public hearing. Any comments, concerns? Okay, very good. Moving on, committee reports. Stormwater Task Force did not meet since our last meeting. And the Agricultural Commission, we had, there was a meeting there just to interview, per se, the new market manager. And it went very well. The farmer's market will be opening up in June. Building reuse?
No meeting, but we had the, well, I guess bid opening for the RFP responses on Friday, but there were no responses. So we have a meeting next Monday to regroup and discuss why we think there was no responses and what we want them to do to move forward. But not great news there.
That's it?
Yep.
All right. What's the next one?
Capital plan has not met.
Not met. All right. School building committee?
School building committee has not met. And Green Communities Task Force meets this Wednesday.
Excellent. MJTC?
MJDC will meet in, I believe, 2 weeks.
Excellent.
No meeting since the last update.
MRPC?
Same thing. Meeting's another week and a half.
Excellent. Open space ad hoc?
Nothing scheduled.
Nothing scheduled. Okay. Well, that completes the committee reports. Development status reports. 270 Electric Ave?
There was a partial certificate of occupancy issued for the first of the indoor climate-controlled storage units. That's the building that includes the office. And if I'm not mistaken, it also includes all of the exterior garage spaces. The second building is being completed, and at the time of occupancy for that, the remainder of the site work will be completed.
Excellent. Excellent. Any questions, comments?
No, just that I noticed that the parking lot at the Walker Orthodontics has also been started.
Yes, and our engineer is aware of that and will be checking in on their excavation.
Excellent. Great. And the director's items, recodification of town general bylaw and zoning bylaw traffic counts. Oh, that was two different things.
It is. That's so. All right. It would be an interesting one item.
Yes.
So the recodification is something that the town clerk has been working on for, a couple of years, if not more, and includes an update to the general bylaws. So what's going to happen is all of the, and this is an article on town meeting, and it is part of our warrant hearings at our next meeting. They're taking all of the general bylaws, all of the zoning bylaws, all of the rules, regulations, all of that kind of procedural stuff, and putting it into one large document called the Code of Lunenburg, or something to, you know, Lunenburgers follow this, something like that. And so it'll have a uniform numbering system and will be divided into chapters per what it is. And so everything will be in one place. So you can have one document that covers everything. Because they're recoding and changing the format of the zoning bylaws, it's technically a zoning bylaw change, which requires a public hearing. So our changes will happen within that framework going forward. What we have coming at this coming town meeting will just be folded into that code outline, and it'll be voted on separate articles. So I don't want there to be any real surprises. It is available to view at the town clerk's office. I think really all it does is it creates an easier access point for all of that information. Mm-hmm. So our rules and regulations for subdivision and site plan and all of that will be folded into that as well. And after town meeting vote, we'll have to hold a hearing to vote to incorporate those into that change. I think it makes more sense to do that afterwards. It's a simple hearing. If it's just a form change, there shouldn't be too much debate about it. And I think preemptively changing it would have caused problems if something happens at town meeting and they don't pass that.
So is that to mean that we're no longer going to have a general bylaw and a zoning bylaw and planning board rules and regulations? They'll all be one thing?
Yes and no.
And how will that be overseen? Will that be overseen? Well, that's going to be a considerable change.
All of those things will remain individually governed in the way that they always have been.
Okay.
But they will be stylistically linked into one document. So if you go to change the planning board rules and regulations, you do it per chapter 41, and you follow those rules, and you as the planning board have industry over what goes into that, but you are locked into a numbering system.
So would you be able to then order, let's say you just wanted to order up the zoning bylaws, you could order that separately, or you could order it up as part of an entire document that included all of those?
We don't generally sell printed versions.
But they are for sale.
I'm saying you're doing it so that you have one resource.
Correct.
Made up of several different resources. Correct. That all fit together perfectly.
Correct.
Okay.
And then the cross-referencing will work.
Okay.
So then to change the subdivision rules and regulations, we still go through the same process. We have a public hearing.
Correct.
Okay. And then...
Will the articles that we are changing now, are they going to be renumbered before the vote or afterward? After. You're saying afterward.
Well, one of them's a deletion.
Yeah.
If that passes, then it will have already been renumbered. And then the...
So we get to the meeting, mm-hmm. town meeting. This will be renumbered to fit the new catalog.
Correct. Okay. Correct.
Thank you.
We have a public question.
David Passios, 56 Whiting Street. I'm assuming this is the appropriate time to bring up my concerns about Section 6.2 Watt monuments being deleted from the protective bylaws.
I'm not sure if this is it? Was that an agenda item?
Well, you were just discussing that it's part. And your town meeting articles, I believe, are on the minute. So the agenda, if it's later,
it works for me.
I don't think it's okay. It's not.
Sure.
A,
I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Okay. I will probably be here at the public hearing that's coming up in April that will address all of these also. But I wanted to come in as soon as possible and express my concern about removing anything that protects property owners in the town of Lunenburg. I understand that, from my perspective, a lack of due diligence with the building department, that this section has not been enforced, and most surveyors apparently don't wish to have to do it. But I think it's a protection against problems down the road is about the only thing I can come up with right now, but especially with the abutters thinking that, oh, my property line's here or it's here. If these lots at some point are not physically and permanently marked, then we're opening up those properties for problems down the road for the owners of those properties, as far as I'm concerned. Verbiage is already in there, why remove it? It's a protection. And I'm speaking as a resident and taxpayer in the town of Lunenburg. I will probably be here. I expect to be here at the hearing representing the Board of Health with their response to this also. Secondly, from my personal experience with property that I own up in the state of New Hampshire, I have a bound problem up there. And most of it has to do with the fact that the deed changes over the years were not properly marked, some of them not properly documented also, but I've walked many miles in the woods in the last 14 months trying to track down corners that were supposedly marked actually back in 1906, and there's no markers there. And it's in an area where they didn't get destroyed or whatever. And there are markers that actually from times before that set by the paper companies when that land up there was split up into 100-acre tracts, and those are solidly in place. But those tracts have been broken up over the years into smaller sections and not properly marked, and now there's all kinds of disagreement as to where the bounds are. So I think this opens properties up here on a smaller scale to that same problem down the road. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. I look forward to that public hearing. So you want to go to traffic counts?
Sure. Okay. So we've been requested put forward any thoughts or opinions or desires that we would have for traffic counts in the coming counting program. So last year was year 4 of the counting program, so we reset to year 1. And the areas up for year 1 are Chase Road. It is a volume count north of Mass Ave. Electric Ave, which is also a volume count south of Mass Ave. We have Mass Ave itself at the Fitchburg line. We have Mass Ave itself southwest of Electric Ave. We have Mass Ave between Chase Road and Electric Ave. You're getting a theme here. Then we have turning movement counts Mass Ave at 2A and 13, and we have Mass Ave turning counts at the intersection of Chase Road. Last year, the additional counts we had done were West Street, Prospect Street, Oak Street, and Pond Street.
Was it Oak Ave
by the? Oak Ave. I'm sorry. That's yes, fine. Up at the new development by the Turkey Hill.
Right.
West, Prospect, Oak Ave, and which one?
And Pond, coming off of the roundabout.
And the ones you're looking for now are in addition to the ones you...
They would be in addition above and beyond. There's the opportunity potentially to have 3 or 4 additional counts done at the town's request. First come, first serve, due to availability, you know, all of the standard disclaimers. The coffee's hot.
Well, I would like to see Oak Ave counted again now that the school is built. The whole purpose in my suggesting Oak Ave in the beginning was to get a existing Oak Ave traffic count, and then so a before and after for the school, because that project we were assured that the traffic would not significantly increase. I believe was the word.
When did they do the counts? A summer thing, like July or something.
I think they try and do them when it's available.
Yeah, you'd have to have those counts done during school
time. 30 June.
Mm. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, 30 June's
not. I remember having the conversation though that after the school was built, we wanted to take another look at it.
Well, I think, you know, unfortunately, it's a weather-driven, time-driven, and most of these agencies hire summer interns to do counting placement and collection. Mm-hmm. So you're usually probably looking somewhere between June 1 and like August 15 for most of this counting to be done. And that's not to say that it isn't done outside of those times, but
yeah, no, that's what I figured. That's why I brought that up.
Have we gotten the intersection of Northfield and 13 done recently? I know we talked about it before. And it came up a lot when we talked about Highfield Village and such.
We talked about them doing
I don't know that we have. I think...
there was a detailed traffic study done there, wasn't there?
I was going to say, I think that when when Highfield was going forward, they may have done it.
We asked them to do it at night.
And I did a traffic study.
Pretty sure we got that information. I can look at the office and see.
Do you think some of these higher density developments like Whalum Luxury Apartments and Hollis Hills would add to the need for some of these? Because did they do like Chase Road at Whalum or Summer Street at Whalum when they did the Chase Road? Summer Street, I meant.
Oh, you mean what?
Because I thought we originally did both sides of Electric with Whalum, right?
Maybe.
And then I was thinking the other end of Whalum at Summer Street.
Yeah, I don't know that they did a lot of traffic counts other than what was already available.
Mm-hmm.
Because they're not looking to really do anything in that process other than safety improvements. And so at an intersection like Whalum and Summer, it wouldn't be anything other than usually alignment corrections to improve visibility or the angle of approach.
Mm-hmm.
Unless they had some crash history where there was a volume issue and someone was looking to install a light.
Mm-hmm. I'm just thinking with Tri-Town, mm-hmm. Whalum Luxury, the development going on in Electric Ave, that intersection might see an increase in
traffic. It may. I think that with Whalum Luxury, counting this year would be sort of preemptive, mm-hmm. right? Which, again, if you're looking to establish a baseline, that's probably not a bad plan.
Mm-hmm.
He has his permits, and he's sort of started going great guns on install of all of the utilities. And I know he's got footings for the first building, but I wouldn't expect anyone to occupy any of that site until fall at the earliest.
Don't we have a baseline from Emerald, when Emerald went in? No?
That would be quite old, wouldn't it?
Well, you're talking, yeah, now you're talking about something that's... What, 10 years old now.
Yeah, that's true, yeah. Yeah, I guess it would make sense.
As a resident of Flat Hill Road, I would like to see a traffic count done on the lane because it is fairly insufficient width and it comes right down to 2A. We've had considerable increase in traffic over the last couple decades with the GIS and the mapping programs. It's a shortcut through Lunenburg to 225.
So you're suggesting the lane at 2A or the lane at Flat Hill?
Lane at 2A, I would say.
Yeah, that's probably the bigger safety issue, right?
Mm-hmm.
And Cross Street's got a pretty narrow spot there at the corner. Just past...
Prospect?
Just past Brockelman's. I'm
trying to think of where you're talking about.
All right, if you go down the lane, 2A, you take the left, and then you take an immediate right, go down over the bridge, and then come up the hill.
Oh, to Mulpus?
Yeah, between 2A and Mulpus.
Okay, yeah.
That's very tight.
You think a lot of people do that, though?
That
doesn't seem like it's very heavily traveled.
No, it doesn't really.
It's pretty.
It is pretty. Brockelmans keep their place nice.
Do you need these tonight, or?
Sooner is always better,
right.
on this type of thing.
Well, I mean, certainly it wouldn't hurt to take a look at at Electric there to see if we can get baseline on Whalum and the if what's the other one that ever gets built?
Hollis.
The
selectmen have it scheduled for April 4th, so they would like them by they said Thursday for recommendations. I mean, Hollis is out there. It's approved to be built. It's, I think, a matter of someone purchasing it from the current owner.
Yeah.
I don't think that that individual has an appetite to do a project of that magnitude, and I think is looking for the appropriate party to sell it to.
So for the baseline on the Whalum Luxury, I think that between Leisure Ave, where the Water District is, and then Pratt Street, which is the next major road?
Yeah.
Would that be?
Yeah, that would be either side of it, yeah.
Right?
That would
get, yeah. There is a Smith Drive, but it looks like a dead end or a private road.
Yeah.
Oh, doesn't even show up when you zoom way in. Yeah, Smith Drive. Interesting. So I think between Leisure Ave and Pratt Street would be the location on Whalum Road.
So not at Summer. You're looking Whalum between Leisure and
Pratt.
Yeah, that would give us that strip, that because there's a lot of side roads that people could be coming on. And
yeah,
off.
That would isolate it.
Yeah, I think the majority of the people turning on to Whalum from Summer Street are going to be coming through, not necessarily.
There's only like a couple of interconnected streets over, you know, across the street. There's not a lot of traffic there.
And if they were going to Tri-Town, they'd probably take Young's Road.
Yeah, probably.
In considering the upcoming reconstruction of Summer Street, do you think it would be, was that what we were talking about? Summer Street?
They must have done counts on.
Well, I'm assuming they would have, yes.
Yeah. I mean, I would assume that the state's going to do counts.
You assume at your own risk.
Yeah. Exactly. Well, I can check with MRPC at the next meeting, but.
That is why I say it as such.
Do we take into account any of these ones that have been done for us by, like, the police? Like, over, I know they did one a daily or a 48 hour over by the deck hockey, right. And then they just recently, I think it was in the application to the ZBA for the car wash, that they said they had like 12,000 cars and their target was to get like six an hour.
Well, they may have used the MRPC counts for their stuff.
Okay.
Interestingly, Summer Street is not a road that gets counted in any of the four-year cycle. I would have to infer that's because there's a feeling that the majority of that traffic has passed through.
Well, let me ask you, I mean, what are we, are we responsible for any of the traffic controls that might go in? In, if there were an instance that we would, you know, find that we need something? I mean, the state's really in charge of that whole thing.
On Summer Street?
Yeah, yeah.
Oh, that design, yeah, I mean, yeah, that design, so, I mean, is more or less in the can. It's
They're going to be doing everything anyway. Yeah. So it's not like the accounting, it's going to, you know.
We're responsible for paying for bits and bobs of it.
Yeah. So I don't know that it's really necessary. I don't know. Unless you're talking about, I mean, there is a lot of cut through on the two Youngs, right? Mm-hmm. And the one across from Youngs. That cuts down the opposite direction to the south. Graham? Is that still Youngs?
Graham Street?
Is that what it is? Yeah.
Well, it actually Graham, ends up, as you take the left, that takes you out to Summer. Yeah. Whalum goes straight and Youngs goes to the right.
Graham, though. Graham?
Oh, okay, yeah.
I mean, if you wanted to get some readings on how much cut through traffic is, you know, will
increase. So you're talking like a turning movement count at those, at that intersections at Graham and Youngs?
Yes, I would say, yeah.
Graham and Youngs don't intersect.
I wasn't sure how far apart they were. I know they're.
No, they don't intersect. Yeah. Youngs, they're close, but.
Do you really think there's cut through traffic there?
Oh, there's a ton of cut through traffic there. Yeah. People cut down Youngs all the time.
I feel like Young's is longer.
Yeah, I do too.
Yeah, I do too.
How do you know that? Well, you tried to cut through.
I have. I'll openly admit that.
Exactly.
Only when the lumber place.
I drive by to reminisce about the drive-in.
Yeah.
That was it Howlett Lumber or something down there?
Yeah, Howlett Lumber. Yeah.
That's the only time I go down that road.
Sign's still up.
Used to be good riding.
There's still some kind of a lumber place there. Is it still called Howlett Lumber?
I don't think they're open.
I think it got sold.
No, really?
Yeah.
It's going to be redeveloped.
Yeah, at any rate, any of those streets down there would be interesting to see how they're affected by Summer Street redevelopment.
So is there anything that anybody feels passionately about?
Not right now.
No, as far as traffic counts.
Well, I mean, I have Oak Ave, Northfield at Chase, the lane at 2A, Whalen between Leisure and Pratt, and turning movement counts for Youngs and or Graham. And if you want, we can submit all five of those to the selectmen and see what their thoughts are. I don't know if anybody thinks that they should be dialed back.
The suggestions, I mean.
Of that list, the lane is the only one I think is of particular interest. But I can see other people's opinions for all of them. So
I feel like last year we had some definite identified areas that you were passionate about. So I think rather than making recommendation, we'll say in our discussion we came up with these five or six potentials and let the selectmen sort of discern what they think might be reasonable. And I'll put a little explanation about each of them in there. And
that would be helpful, I think.
Yeah. That way they can sort of at least get your input. And since, again, there isn't a, well, this is super important, they can kind of drive that process at this point.
Okay.
So guys, we got a town meeting coming up May 6th.
So I heard.
And you received one last final add-on article that I did submit for the warrant. We still have time to yank it if the board doesn't want to be the sponsor of it. And I'll explain why I put it in and sort of what the implications are. So I went to the CPTC and I saw Greg there and we sat and talked pot with probably about 100 other people. And really what it comes down to is it's the moratorium till December of 2018 on the location of recreational marijuana facilities within the town of Lunenburg. And the idea is that the way the referendum that passed in November was written creates essentially a new agency within the Commonwealth, the Cannabis Control Commission, which is a three-member board that is most closely equivalent to the ABCC, the Alcohol Beverage Control Board, with some sort of minor differences, but that's kind of a little wonky for what we're talking about. And that is formed with advisement from the Cannabis Advisory Board, which is a 15-member advisory board made up of specifically identified individuals, and they're specifically identified by their job category and knowledge base. And these two bodies are responsible for creating the application process for recreational marijuana facility licensing, which has not been even conceived of to this point. So as part of their turn of the year session, the legislature extended the deadline to have regulations and begin issuing licenses from January of 2018 to July 1st of 2018. And they're required to have draft regulations out by March 15th of 2018. I think it's right around there. So the Attorney General has been fielding a lot of questions and has come out advising communities that if they plan to either place a moratorium or regulate the location of recreational marijuana facilities, they need to have rules in place or zoning in place prior to the issuance of those draft rules. And so in order to comply with the Attorney General, who I would suggest is probably someone we want to be on the good side of, I put the moratorium in with the understanding that we have the ability at any time to create rules and remove the moratorium, but I would rather have stuff in place and not be sort of chasing this for November or get to the point where the draft rules are issued and we're like, oh, well, we really don't like that, and now we're either walking a fine line of being up against it or unable to stop something. So this gives us till December of 18. Excuse me. It would allow us any time between now and then, based on information that we gather from the state, to move forward with crafting use definitions, time and place regulations that would fall in line with what the referendum is, what the legislature has done, and what the Cannabis Control Commission might do. I think really part of the even more, to add more moving parts, the legislature has, I think it's something like 40 bills on the docket that propose to change the legislation from the way it was approved, in from minor things to potentially major things, and they haven't sorted that all out. So again, I think what we're trying to do, and what I'm trying to do, is just give us the ability to say no up front and have some time to sort of ease into what we want to do with it.
So that brings up a couple questions in my mind. You say the moratorium will go till 2018 December,
mm-hmm.
but the state regs are not due until 3 months after that?
No.
Before that.
Before that. They're doing March of 18.
Okay, there we go. Awesome. So we've also already had somebody come to us with something like that. Is that likely to scare that applicant away? Or if we've got a moratorium in place, we can't just...
Someone came to us for
the on Mass Ave.
That was purely for a cultivation facility. He didn't indicate who would be cultivating in there, and he actually indicated that he currently has an RMD license, and that facility would be the first.
And that would be
first licensee. Yes, and the RMD we have a bylaw for, and is. It's two silos. You know, we've got medicine over here, we've got recreation over here.
Mm-hmm.
And my understanding is that the two shall not mingle unless the CCC writes rules that allows it or really just drags their feet and we get to July 1st of 2018 and CCC hasn't done anything. Every operating registered marijuana dispensary then has the ability to operate as a normal retail location.
Okay.
For any and all comers.
Really?
Who are 21 and over.
Okay.
Right, and I think, sorry if
no,
I may.
No, please.
But yeah, they said that they were going to give the first 75, that medical...
First 79.
79, the basically first right of refusal, I would say. Oh, first opportunity to
switch
over.
Yeah, the first round of licensing is only open to, I think the wording is established purveyors or something to that. So if you have an approved RMD license or are currently operating an RMD, you're allowed to apply in that first round. And then the second round, which I think comes in 2019, is open to anybody. So, you know, Bob and Joe, who own a head shop and, you know, little town Western Mass, can't apply to the first round if they're not in on the RMD. But the second round, have at anybody can do it.
Right. And I believe they said we only had, eight operating?
Yeah, I think there's eight or nine operating.
Do you think that this will cause people to apply under medical to get to that 79?
No.
No?
Okay. I don't. I think that the way the medical process has unfolded over time, it's incredibly time-consuming. It's incredibly expensive. If I'm not mistaken, I think that the initial license applications were $50,000.
Yeah.
And that was also a lottery, if I recall correctly.
Well, the initial was, but I don't think the $50,000 has changed. I think just how you apply has changed. And the level of review that goes into the medical is extremely stringent. You know, I in a former position, I dealt with a couple of different people who were applying, and some very, you know, brainy and well-groomed business people who were rejected in favor of people who had more qualifications. So I don't think that anybody is just going to walk in off the street and A, have that kind of cash, and B, get vetted through that process the way they are. I think that there's probably hundreds of applications in process in one form or another in that sphere. So there may be 79 people by the time they get to licensing that have been vetted through DPH and are well on their way to opening, but haven't actually crossed the final hurdle.
Mm-hmm. Another thing that brought up in my mind was if we put the moratorium in place, you said that we could take it out?
Correct.
But don't we have to go to town meeting to remove that?
Well, yes. The purpose of the moratorium is to allow the town a finite period of time with which to address the planning and regulation issues that of the business or use that they're trying to stop in that period. So, and Greg and I had a conversation about this. If, let's say, in January of next year, they come out and the CCC is like, look at this, we're ahead of schedule, here's our draft regs, and we look at them and say, oh, we can live with these things, let's write a use and put it on the annual town meeting. And we go to town meeting in May of 18 because, hey, everybody wants to allow us to get something open for July 1st, and we want to start moving that process. And we go to town meeting and we institute use definitions that cover all of the various recreational marijuana components, and we feel that that covers everything that we want to cover, complies with the state law, that in and of itself would eliminate the moratorium. And I guess, I mean, I would say that it would be even more clear that at the time we do that, we then strike the moratorium through its own article in case, for whatever reason, the definitions don't pass. Anytime that we come up with our own set of bylaws and regulations, it eliminates the moratorium. So it's not just, oh, we're just going to hold off for 18 months and not do anything, and then at the end of 18 months, we're just going to let everyone have at it. It's to do a planning process and to comply with what the law says and how we want to do it to fit into that.
So just a technical question.
Sure.
Here. So the moratorium has to be put in place by a vote of the public.
Correct.
At town meeting.
Correct.
But if we pass a set of laws and regulations that basically make it functionally dead,
mm-hmm.
That's fine. You don't have to remove it at another town meeting by public vote.
When do we do this? We have them both at the same time.
We have to do the public.
We have to do a bylaw. Right, so that has to go to the town meeting. So if that gets passed,
yeah,
then you just remove.
Ask them to remove that as yeah. Well. Okay.
So and you don't have to, because if you read the text of it.
Yeah, I know the clock will run out on it.
Oh, no, but if you read the text of it, it says. For set reasons above, notwithstanding any other provision of zoning country, the town adopts temporary moratorium. The moratorium shall be in effect until December 18. I guess it doesn't say it, but I would suggest that I thought I did put something in there.
Might want to put something in.
I can work on something, or we can just, you know, remove it at the time that we come up with the new laws.
Yeah, I was just assuming we would remove it when we come up with the bylaw.
So that leaves us having to have a bylaw ready for the fall town meeting next year.
Correct.
At a minimum, or at the latest.
Worst case.
And that'll be a completely separate bylaw than our medical marijuana, or are we going to just do one marijuana bylaw?
I don't know.
It's up to us, right?
Again, I think it's incredibly difficult to say right now.
Hence the need for a moratorium?
Well, yeah, it because there's no guidance on which direction the state is going to go. There's no guidance on what the legislature might do to slip in there. It might say you have to do them separately. It might say, who knows what it might say. So it would just be a matter of either inserting it into the use table or creating a bylaw section for it.
Okay.
So that puts us in a tight spot if the state doesn't come out with regulations till March, which is when our regular town meeting warrant closes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's not a lot of time.
Yeah.
Well, are you guessing we're going to get like a model?
Yeah, I was going to say they'll have drafts earlier than that, won't they?
Yeah.
No, the draft is due the 15th.
Well, the draft.
And then they take applications April 1st, and their actual final regulations aren't due until after they're allowed to start opening stores. Right. So it's kind of a
cart before the horse.
It's a timeline that, and I'll send you the timeline for next week. But there, it's
tight.
Interesting, weird. This is what happens when an industry writes their own referendum that they are pretty sure will pass, and you know, they write what they want. I don't think that there's any language that's a mistake, and I think that, you know, the experts, the lawyer, and the other planner who put on the forum, who did a lot of the have done incredible amounts of research on this, had said the same thing. You know, all of this seems very specific, and it doesn't mesh together well. I'm not convinced they intentionally messed with the timelines in MGL for the municipalities, but the way they wrote the language is intended to give them, you know, eliminate certain things. Like, they have a clause that says that you can't unreasonably regulate it as a use, which means it can't be a special permit. Special permit is subjective and can be easily classed as unreasonable regulation.
Huh. That puts us in a spot, doesn't it?
Well, I just want to bring up, like, called Adam earlier today to talk about this. I understand everything you're saying about putting the moratorium in place, but I also remember back when I started with the planning board, the medical use laws were just coming out too, and we were advised to put a moratorium in for all the same reasons, and the board said, yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And then we went to town meeting with the article and got a resounding no to the moratorium because the people wanted it in town and wanted us to come up with a bylaw quickly. And even when we put that medical use bylaw together, the board at the time was pretty in favor of trying to make it work for people, and ended up getting supported at town meeting to vote that bylaw into place. So,
well, I believe at that point they also had a draft out for it by the state, and my recollection is that we already had a draft, and we went with, and that was the same year that it was on the ballot, right? To legalize medicinal marijuana? Was it the year before? Either way, it was a resounding yes by the town to legalize it, and then we had a draft bylaw by the state, and we chose to go with the moratorium rather than put the bylaw together. So I can see why that would have gotten turned down by the town, but we definitely have the ability to explain to them that we don't have a model or draft or anything from the state.
Or even guidance.
Exactly.
Okay. Just saying, I've heard this story before. Yeah. And it played out a different way than we expected.
And I do appreciate that, you know, that recollection and knowing that we're going to step on town meeting floor with that as a possibility. And I think that it's worth knowing and it's important. And again, you know, if the board doesn't want to go forward with the moratorium, I'm okay with that. I think that it was important to try and do it now rather than hope to do it in November.
Should we add, in light of that, should we add wording to the moratorium that it is until the town establishes and accepts a
I'll put something in the...
So that it doesn't make it sound like we're just pushing this out to the end of 2018, that we are going to aggressively work on the bylaw and get it in, but in the meantime, until we got something that the town liked, we didn't want anything to happen. So if we had that kind of wording to it, maybe it would go a little bit easier on the floor.
I think that's exactly how we said it last time.
Oh, really? The value of the history, huh? So what would you recommend?
No, I agree with Adam's reasoning and putting it off, but just saying that seems, from my experience with special town meeting, the town seems to be pretty pro having marijuana use in town, so
I think it's interesting. I don't know if it correlates or not, but what the do we know what the count was on the vote in town?
I don't remember. It was
tried to look it up. It wasn't posted on the website, but I know the medical when it passed, but through the state, it was like 70-30.
Yeah, I think this
one was
like
more like
58-42, something like that.
Oh, okay. So it was still to the positive.
It was. Yeah. Oh, yeah. We were on the positive side of it. I won't say it was close, but it wasn't razor thin.
Yeah.
I won't say it was a huge majority for, but it wasn't a razor thin win.
Not that, I mean, it doesn't translate to a special town meeting or any other town meeting.
Well, it does. I mean, Westboro has done a ballot measure and has prohibited the marijuana, recreational marijuana retail as a use.
Yeah.
And they have a zoning bylaw and a general bylaw on their upcoming town meeting. But their townwide vote was 80% against.
Yeah.
So it's, you know, that would be, you'd have a hard sell to put anything other than a no in that community.
Sure. Yeah.
Do you feel possibly having a handout? Is this going to be handed out at
that
town
be in
meeting?
The
or yeah, right, but I think it may be helpful just to give a cover
I'm going to send you the timeline, and I think that would be a good handout to have because it shows what the state's timeline is, what our timeline is, and we can put together some, like a bullet point fact sheet or something to that effect.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Yeah, I just think it's important that people know that what if we pass it, what's going to happen, and if they don't pass it, what the consequences of that could be.
Definitely. I mean, I agree. That's the kind of thing that I think you can get up there and sell at town meeting, you know.
And
what's going to happen in either case.
To play devil's advocate, if it doesn't pass, we're going to have to get started on it almost immediately, correct? Or
yeah, I mean, I guess so. They can't issue licenses. They can't open until July 1st. They start taking license applications in April. The way that they're predicting the licensing will work is it gets filed with the state. The state reviews it for them, and they basically send the municipality a note that says, hey, they want to do this. Does this meet your bylaws? Yes or no? It's like, you know.
So why isn't it run more like liquor? Like, why isn't it?
Because the marijuana industry wrote the law.
Their own law.
And prohibition was back in the 30s.
Yeah, but I mean, we have control of liquor selling establishments in town.
Yes,
by license.
Liquor sales come here first.
Right.
Now, whether or not there will be a local state license component allowed, that's entirely possible, but it's not looking that way.
Really? Okay.
I mean, even if we don't have a bylaw in place, at most it could go into the locations where we have a zone for medical use, right?
Well, no, they're separate, he's saying.
Yeah.
It could be everywhere.
We would have to add the use to the use table and figure out where we want it.
I would say it would most closely be analogous with retail. So it would be allowed where we allow retail.
In the center. To answer Dave's question, the question three, marijuana in the November 6, 2012 election, the yeses out of a total of 5919, so almost 6,000 people, the yes votes were 3,625, the no votes were 2,117. So the difference was almost 1,500 in favor.
Okay. So I don't think we're a bunch of Puritans anymore sitting up here in Lunenburg, but so I'm in favor of the moratorium, I guess, but I'm not going to lean too hard on it if we get pushback from the people.
You know, in most instances, that's my feeling about bylaws. We feel this is the best approach to what we're doing, and, you know, that's what town meeting is for.
And the moratorium is going to be one of our public hearings for the article?
No, that will actually be on the 24th.
Fourth, right.
So yes, it will be a public hearing, but it will be on the 24th because some timing.
So we've got
I'm actually in favor of two. My concern was getting stuck in the moratorium.
Yeah, no, we won't get stuck in it.
Okay. That's what I was concerned about.
All right. So anything more on the temporary moratorium? All right. Notices and communications? You there already?
When you don't have any public hearings.
Wow. Okay.
They've all been scanned to you?
Yep.
I don't know if anybody has any questions.
Now, did we decide that we were going to talk about the use table today, or...?
Under the pending items.
Okay.
So, I mean, you could move that up to now if you wanted to do that and leave meeting schedule for afterwards?
Well, I just wanted to make sure that it was something that we wanted to talk about.
Right.
So we can go ahead and move right along. Meeting schedule.
So next meeting, we'll have our bylaw hearings, including the recodification, the lot monuments, the driveways and entrances, and then... On the 24th, we've got the water district coming in and the marijuana moratorium.
Very good. So we're back at public comment. Is there any public comment?
I do have one public comment.
Oh, okay.
Just that we did have the caucus, and there are two open seats on the sewer commission. So if anybody wants to, or two open ballots. Spots actually on the sewer commission,
and you can take out papers until Thursday.
Mm-hmm.
The town clerk.
They need to be back by Thursday.
Right, the papers need to be taken out, and 42 signatures minimum.
Yes, 42.
42, and but you could also go with a write-in campaign.
The write-ins always work. Yeah, it doesn't necessarily mean that the person's going to want the position, but. all right, so that's public comments, pending items, definitions, and use table.
So we had the one sheet with the page and a half was the, I think, the only definitions we hadn't nailed down.
Did everybody bring their material?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So hopefully we've all reviewed them. I don't know if anybody has questions, comments.
You talked about, or I mentioned covering the differences between lots
and stuff. Yeah, and that's going to go back into the other definitions.
Okay.
So that will be a separate section.
Okay.
Because these are use definitions,
right.
And those are term definitions, okay. And so I don't want to commingle them.
Nope, makes sense. Thank you.
I was just
wanted to make sure that we were covering it somewhere.
So I was working on a project today, in fact, in Rowley, and I was looking at their bylaw. Their definition of accessory in-law apartments included ownership and use requirements.
Okay. And I've seen that before. Generally, what that says, and I don't know if I'm trying to remember, is that one of the two units needs to be occupied by the property owner.
Mm-hmm.
And the intent is that you don't create a multi-unit rental.
Right.
And that has generally stood the test with the Attorney General. And we do have that. One of the units shall be occupied by the owner of the property. It's number 9 under the conditions. It's on the back page of there.
The back page?
No, the front, first sheet. Back of the first sheet.
Okay.
Number 9.
They also said that the special permit for an accessory in-law apartment shall terminate upon transfer of ownership of the subject premises or upon mm-hmm. the undersigned's termination. We have that as well?
We do not, because we do not require a special permit for accessory dwelling.
Okay. That might touch upon some of the intricacies that we've had about detached or attached or whatnot. I mean, making a special permit would...
I'm sorry, so you're saying if it were a special permit, it would be null and void upon transfer of the property ownership?
That's a possibility. I mean, that's what they have in their wording. And there was concern about transference of property. If you've got a detached accessory use and you sell it, mm-hmm. then how are you going to regulate it once it's sold? But if this was in place, then the new owner would need to reapply.
I've also seen it done where they can apply for an administrative continuance of the special permit. So they basically come in and say, we're going to do this, and there's a series of documents that they're required to sign and record against the deed that says that they understand that there's an accessory unit, that they're the property owner, that they'll be occupying one of the two units, you know, for the period that they own the house, and it just gets recorded so that in a title search that pops up and it's not surprising, and if they decide to move out and, you know, the code officer goes and says, oh, well, you're not living there. Well, we never knew. Well, be pretty hard pressed to say you didn't know if you recorded a document that you signed saying that you would do that. So it's one way to control that. I don't know.
Requires a special permit for every time somebody wants to do that?
Yeah, and I don't know that that's the cleanest or expeditious way to do that. I my experience with accessory units here in town is that they haven't really been a problem
mm-hmm.
outside of just getting general code compliance, and maybe I don't know if Mr. Passios wants to talk about any septic issues that may have come up from accessory units. I know that there can be issues with sharing a septic and stuff like that. I wouldn't ever claim to be a Title V expert.
Mm-hmm.
As a board member, I've only been involved with one that was done recently down in the Hickory Hills area, and that was reviewed by our board, mm-hmm. and everything was in place properly. Usually, my understanding, now this is my personal understanding, is that when these are approved by the Zoning Board of Appeals, that's contingent on approval by other boards, i.e. Board of Health, that the septic system will handle it or has been designed for that purpose. That's the best I can give you at this point.
My understanding from speaking to them before was, as long as the room count aligns and it's been built for the provisions of having two connections.
Correct.
And it's fine by the Board of
Health. I would like to make one comment, though. It's my understanding that a special permit, once approved on a property, stays with the property forever in this town.
A variance stays forever. A special permit can be conditioned to either owner or specified use. I would have to look further, but it would be very surprising to me if they allowed a special permit to be continued in perpetuity. Now, often
I've just heard that. I've never researched it.
Certain special permits, if you get the approval,
thank you.
The use may be able to carry on, like a dimensional variation. We allow special permits for that. That doesn't go away with transfer. That would really kind of be draconian in implementation, but especially a lot of use special permits, they will oftentimes condition to the life of the applicant, only because if Ken runs a restaurant, he may be the most conscientious restaurateur in town and have his own, you know, specific way of doing something, and he sells it to someone else, that person may or may not be of the same operational quality. So they have, you may have the ability to come and extend that special permit at conveyance as part of the, you know, pre-conveyance, but it would, it can be conditioned that it would terminate with the abandonment of the property or something to that effect.
A sale or transfer?
Sale or transfer, yeah.
So I just personally would have big reservations about associating a special permit with the accessory dwellings, because out of anything in these definitions, and for such a low impact use, I think has the greatest possibility to help people in town, is from parents moving back in to kids who won't move out. I think it will positively affect the most amount of people in town.
I agree.
And it should be accessible for people to use.
Yeah.
All right, was there any further?
Well, personally, the commercial solar.
You don't like that, right?
I don't like that.
You don't like the definition?
I don't.
Okay.
I don't like the majority.
Okay.
Portion of that.
I think the majority is very important to that.
And I'll tell you why I wrote it that way.
Because you sell back excess.
That's fine. And you can say, with the exception of sales back to the power provider.
So what if you sell back 90% of your electricity?
Back to the power provider.
Doesn't that become a majority?
That does.
So that makes it commercial. So if you're consuming less than 50% of the electricity generated by the solar unit, and you're selling back your excess, that would constitute a commercial.
No, yep. Only if you're selling it back to them. If you're selling it as a business, if your business is selling it to other people, you're contracting with others to purchase the, whether it be the RECs or whatever you're doing with it, that is commercial to me. If you're getting, if you get excess power, right, that's going to go somewhere. So obviously that's going to go back into the system. That I don't have a problem with. If it's one purchaser, it's going back to them.
So you want to be so specific
that you just say that, yeah, with the exception, like Lincoln does it, with the exception of selling back to the grid, whoever the, you know, in this case it would be Unitil.
So
if I put up a solar photovoltaic system on my property that generates so much electricity that 90% of it gets sold back to Unitil, they send me a check every month. You don't want to consider that a commercial solar installation.
No, I don't. Okay. Yeah, I wouldn't want to see.
So if I put up a megawatt and a half,
you're talking about incentivizing. I don't want to see it incentivized so that people can just start putting up commercial solar on, you know, whatever their back acreage is, in the middle of a residential neighborhood, and start selling it. I got no problem. If they need it for accessory use, it's going to stay with the property. No problem. Okay.
What if only 1% of it stays with the property?
That what this definition says, though?
Yeah. What if only 1% of it gets used on the property and the other 99% gets sold?
To Unitil.
Still not commercial to you?
Not if it's going back to them. Back to Unitil. If they oversize it,
well,
what other reason would they
have? Let's use Chase Road.
What reason would they have to put up a system that generates more than they need?
Make money.
That's what I'm saying, right? To become a commercial establishment.
No, but Unitil's paying
money.
Them.
Unitil pays you for it. I understand. So I can make money off of my solar grid in my yard.
Well, then that is commercial. If you want to look at it that way, yeah.
I mean, that's kind of how I'm viewing it. Right. I mean, Mr. Chair, sorry to interrupt, but I mean, I had recommended this be added as a definition, and my intent is that everybody should have the ability to provide all of their electricity through solar on site. I think we ran into it on Pleasant Street that I want to avoid people chasing the dollar and selling out their neighbors by putting in these ground-mounted systems that they're more concerned with making money than
that's why I think
what
it goes hand
benefits.
It goes hand in hand with an accessory use definition.
So to me, any of which will not be used on site is considered.
No, you can't say that because there's always an ebb and flow.
Right, you're never going to get 100 right. Exactly.
Sometimes you're going to be paying, right. And sometimes you're going to be being paid. Right.
Right,
so,
right.
So I think majority is a great qualifier there, which means if you've purposely sized the system to be more than twice as big as it needs to be, you're intending to always be making money off of it, which makes it a commercial enterprise. If you've sized it appropriately, sometimes mm-hmm. you'll make money, sometimes you lose money, which makes it, in my opinion, not commercial. It's just a normal solar installation for. I don't think that we should qualify whether it's ground-mounted or roof-mounted, but I think this is a really good way of defining it, because if you put a system that's so big that you're not using the majority of the electricity it generates, then clearly your intent is commercial.
Well, I think Chase Road is a good example. They, I believe it's the one on Chase Road, they sell their power to Unitil.
Yeah.
And they pay the town, or Unitil pays the town. So they're not technically selling it to the town. The town's just reaping financial benefits from it. Mm-hmm.
And they do use some of that electricity on site mm-hmm. to manage the site.
Oh, no,
so only 99% of it actually goes back.
Right. Okay, so let me think about that, because that's actually the way that you're saying it, that does make sense. So...
So I think majority is a key word to that. I actually underlined it when I read the...
So let's say you need... Well, let's use a real example. This gentleman down on Lemonster Road mm-hmm. who applied to the zoning board for a dimensional variation because he needs to put a ground-mounted system in. Mm-hmm. That is... I think it was 18 kW.
The most recent one?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because he has a horse barn, and he has a decent-sized house, and where he is, and the way his house is, the roof-mounted system just won't work.
Yeah, I saw that. Yeah.
So the 18 kW is going to run his whole yard, his whole 90% of his needs. If he decided, you know what, by the time I lay the panels out, it's really going to be 20, but I only need 17. Mm-hmm. He's not doing that to make money. He's doing it to... put a system in that's appropriately laid out and blah, 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 blah.
Right.
And so he's got some that he's...
And even if it's oversized a little bit, the majority of the electricity is going to be used mm-hmm. on that property.
His intent yeah. isn't putting it in order to create a business opportunity.
That's true. I guess, you know, now that I'm thinking about it, he's right, because if it's going to be accessory, the majority of it will be accessory, and anything above that will be, you'd have to have a massive system. Or a massive need. To install a massive system with those guidelines. So yeah, that's actually not bad now that I'm thinking about it.
Yeah, the only thing I'm maybe throws me off a little bit is the fact that it lists out a roof, because potentially a bigger store like a Walmart or something mm-hmm. like that could cover their roof, generate more, significantly more than they need for the store.
Well, I think in that instance, it's a matter of then allowing it within maybe retail, commercial, and industrial districts, and prohibiting it in residential districts.
It's just from the fact, I'm just splitting hairs, because you would never know it's up there because it's on a building.
Well,
so it's kind of clearly the
why we'd allow it in a commercial district, and then Walmart could go all day and put up a commercial solar as an accessory.
Yeah, but
you,
at the same time, you wouldn't want to see one sitting on the ground just because it's in commercial or business. I'm talking.
Mm-hmm.
The fact that it's on a building, on a roof, and it fits on the roof kind of makes it secondary in use to me.
Well, yeah, we have a deal through Nexamp. There's one, the 650 kilowatts that's roof-mounted that we buy from. That's one of our, they just approved two town meetings ago, or last year's annual town meeting.
Damon, I'm sorry, so what is your contention about the way that it's written about the roof?
Just that it lists out on the ground, on the roof, or on a structure. So
it's really regardless is what you're saying, regardless of what kind it is?
Yeah, I suppose as long as it's on a roof, I feel it doesn't quite meet the commercial.
He's saying any roof-mounted system should be taken out of the commercial solar discussion.
Why? Well, I think our regulations already regulate ground mount, but not roof mount, right?
Roof mount's allowed it by right.
Exactly, so yeah, it shouldn't be mentioned, I would think. If it's allowed by right, then, well, I guess the definition.
And I guess looking at most houses, you're not going to be able to put enough panels where you're not going to use the majority of them on site. Outside of,
you can build a roof structure.
Yeah, well,
seriously,
I mean,
there's no regulation against it.
You
can put up a gigantic barn-like roof structure just for the solar, and it bypasses. You can put a commercial in your yard today by the current bylaw. Because the current bylaw is not based on use, it's based on where you locate the panels.
That's right.
Which, in my opinion, was one of the flaws in the bylaw.
I see both sides of the argument. I just think that in a society where we're trying to encourage renewable energy, and if it's on a roof and it blends in with the building, I don't see it as being that obstructive and hazardous to the neighbors. I totally get the ground mount ones and the way that those look, and they eat up a lot of land that wasn't already being eaten up by the building. But if it's just...
Well, I don't think it's... I mean, to me, it's the commercialization of it, which provides the incentive to, whether it's on the roof or on the ground, to go big or go home, you know? And it's that... I don't care where it is, necessarily, which kind you're using. I just don't want it to be commercialized in residential areas.
As I say, your issue is residential
areas. In residential areas. Correct. Oh, yeah, if it's in commercial zone or an industrial zone, I don't care.
Well,
as long as it's permitted properly.
Let me play with it, and maybe we can use roof only in residential and allow, you know, eliminate roof in commercial. Let me...
Right, because that's...
There may be some way to define that difference. Because you're right. I mean, on top of Walmart or Hannaford, what does it matter how many panels are up there?
But they're already in commercial.
But they're in commercial. That's the
they're
thing.
And I think what Damon is saying is, do you want to allow ground-mounted commercial systems in the commercial zone?
If I don't mind.
If they have proper setbacks. And
if the proper, yeah.
If they meet the rest of the bylaw.
Yeah, if they hold up to the bylaw, why not?
That's like any other commercial business. I mean, my concern is that anybody with 5-10 acres is going to throw in a power plant in their backyard. In any other industry, if you wanted to do that, you could rent, lease, or buy commercial or industrial land and do it, which is fine. But my concern
is, if anyone who has a farm, like if Stillman's wanted to come in and cover one of their roofs with it, they would clearly generate more.
Yeah, I don't. Again, the roof mount, I'm not seeing a huge issue.
If they're using it, if it's accessory,
they could clearly. They have enough roof space to generate more than what they'd ever use.
Correct, but if they let's go back to Ken's explanation. If it's beyond the, if it's over the majority,
the concern is that they would be classified as commercial solar, but you want to allow that.
Yeah,
right.
Because they're just using your existing roof space. And they're not hurting anything,
which is allowed again by right under the bylaw.
Well, Stillman's is already commercial. It's a commercial farm. It's commercial agriculture.
Yeah, but we're a right to farm community.
But the land is zoned residential.
Right, so there's a commercial use in the residential already, but it's a farm and not a solar field.
Solar farm.
Yeah.
There's no place in solar for farm. But
panel sandwich.
Or anybody who has the horse barn like you're talking about. Somebody who has a large structure. What?
There's plenty of them.
Again, I would hesitate to say that somebody who has a situation like that would need to go through the hoops that we would want to make a real commercial solar entity go through.
Mr. Chairman?
Sure, come on up.
On this issue. Only because I've just installed a roof-mounted system on a residential lot.
Were you able to hook to the grid?
Yes.
Awesome.
Yes, it was hooked up December 30th. 2 points.
One of the reasons that some of the residential roof-mounted, now I'm talking about at this point, systems are being oversized is in anticipation of storage capacity becoming available that can be retrofitted to the systems. Thus meaning you need to be able to recharge your batteries as well as cover your use on the property so that you can use that power that it's produced during the day to charge the batteries to be used at night. Secondly, it was from my understanding that there is a limit on the kilowatt capacity that you can ground mount on a residential lot.
There is.
For less than 20 acres. Right. If you've got a residential lot with 20 acres or more, then I believe that you're allowed the
special permit. You go by the regular special permit process.
And I think that sort of part of, I think, Greg's intent on getting this in here is that at some point in the near future, the solar bylaw is going to hit the table for reshaping in some way.
Right.
And this would sort of set
some of that in a
direction that I think the board has at least intimated that they would like to sort of take this, get away from a fixed kilowatt and start looking at the actual land use and the impact on the location, the site that it's located at, as well as the surrounding areas, as more of a footprint issue than as a, and maybe I'm sort of projecting my own thoughts onto the board, but a footprint issue as opposed to an energy production issue.
Yeah, because that's also going to be a problem too, because as the technology gets more advanced, it's taking up less space.
We're going to start creating, you know, megawatts on smaller and smaller footprints, and and is that necessarily problematic in the same way that, you know, having to need 5 acres to put a megawatt in is? Because I don't think that the generation of power in a residential area is necessarily the crux of this issue. I think it's the visual and land use impact on the neighborhood. If someone were running a power plant and needed, it was coal-fired, the need to put that in an industrial area is based more on the impacts of a coal-fired power plant than the fact that electricity is traveling out of that facility and into the grid. If you could put a megawatt on something the size of this stage and you had an acre of land, there's, you know, incredibly minimal impact on that. And I can't think of anybody I know who would use a megawatt on a residential use.
I understand that. And I am more than willing to give some thought to Damon's arguments, because now that I'm thinking about it, you know, it's, this whole thing is always sort of a moving target anyway. But yeah, it does make sense, Damon. So I'd love to just think that over.
Yeah.
My problem is with, as happened on Pleasant Street. First you're told, oh, it's an accessory use. How is it an accessory use? It's accessory to the church. Well, the church is leasing the land to a corporation that's in New Jersey. Oh, well, that's okay. It's still accessory because they own it. Oh, church couldn't afford it, had to sell it. Now they bought it. It's zoned. Now it gets to sit there. And who owns it? Nobody I know. I got a problem. I can't go knock on their door. Hey, hello, where are you? Nothing can be done. You don't have a neighbor. You have a business that's sitting in they are just a business. If that were, you know, Joe's Cars, and it's a field full of cars, and this, where's Joe? He's nowhere to be found. You can't complain to anybody. It's just there.
I think that a lot of those issues can be addressed.
Well, but this is the problem with putting something, this has always been the problem with having commercial uses, primary commercial uses in residential zones. So if it's not accessory to the building, then what's the building for? Is it a residence anymore? Is this a house anymore? Or are you just a solar generating facility? So at some point you cross a line, whether it's roof mounted or ground mounted or whatever. What is the purpose of this house in this residence, in this neighborhood?
And I think that that's all stuff that we need to hash out as we readdress the solar bylaw and what, you know, what that means and how it applies and what the various scenarios may be.
Yeah. So I like the definition better now. Thank you, Ken. But there are definitely some, I like the roof thing initially. Maybe we revisit it?
Yeah, so that's fine. Or even if this is the definition, and when you craft the real bylaw changes, it accounts for roof mounted as not needing to fit whatever criteria.
Right.
But, yeah, I mean, again, just to touch on your last point, people are allowed to have home businesses up to a certain point. So the fact that it doesn't hurt the neighborhood, so to the same point, they could but realistically generate some money from a solar thing to the point that it doesn't affect the neighborhood.
And it can't, like you're saying, it can't become the primary use of the residence.
Right.
Right. So there have to be some limits. I mean, and it's really not fair to say, well, you know, neighbors will show up and complain and that'll be our, you know, that's not the way we do things. Mm-hmm. There has to be some kind of a structure in place. So.
All right. What's the next one?
It's a fine line, man.
I know it
is. No one's preventing you from cutting down all your trees and putting in a horse farm.
Yeah, well, that's true.
So. I have one thing on indoor entertainment, Adam.
Okay.
I wasn't sure if you wanted to add and drink after food or drink, food and or drink.
Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. Just wanted to...
I mean, do we have a preference, food and or, food and drink?
Well, I'm just thinking of, you
food
know...
Food and or drink.
There's indoor there's indoor entertainment establishments that just, like, serve beer and wine and stuff that might not necessarily serve food.
Mm-hmm.
So that's why I thought and or might make sense there.
And or is inclusive and not exclusionary.
Correct.
Right.
Right. I think that works, right?
And did you say you did not want to add anything in reference to marijuana in the definitions?
I'm hesitant to.
Marijuana retail sales, anything
at this
like
time?
That?
Well, if you look at the moratorium, there are a series of definitions.
Yeah.
We certainly could ship those over. I wouldn't want to assign them.
No, but we'll have them when we go to construct the bylaws. We'll have the definitions defined.
Yeah, may as well start now, right?
Sure. That's fine. I can pick them up and put them in. I mean, do you want to talk about them as they're written, or did you look at them and think that they were honky-dory?
Let me just re-review.
Honky-dory.
Well, there's quite a few here, actually.
Yeah, there is.
Yeah. Do you feel that manufacturer and...
I think retailer.
Well, I would say if we were going to put uses in there, it would be retailer, testing facility. I missed a...
yep, marijuana.
A carriage return. So marijuana product manufacturer would be a use. Marijuana cultivator would be a use, and those would be the ones. So it'd be marijuana cultivator, marijuana product manufacturer, marijuana testing facility, and marijuana retailer.
Yep.
Because I think they all have very different impacts. I mean, a testing facility is pretty low key. Even a product manufacturer could be low key. Because they're pretty much a locked-up factory processing a plant into other goods and forms. You know, retailer, cultivator is I think things that people think about
and either want to encourage or have concerns about. But I think all four of those have some potential to be located.
Yep.
And I would say that
product manufacturers and test facilities and cultivators all have some effluent issues that might come along with them.
Yeah.
As far as, you know, they need to be hooked up to sewer or have some
containment
system for whatever comes out of their pipes.
Yeah.
Whether it's, you know, a leftover butane or
just the THC itself, if
yeah.
it's getting away, yeah.
Or even, you know, so far as massive amounts of fertilized water that may run off. So if you want, I can sort of ship those over. And as we go forward, I think that if the board has, and this is something that's sort of come to light in having the current interim building inspector, we have a lot of definitions that include provided that clauses after them. And so essentially, if they can't meet those provided that additions, they can't do the business because you can't give them a use variance because we don't allow use variances. So there's a car wash in front of the ZBA over on Electric Ave. And one of the provided that's in that definition is that there is an attendant on site or available, I think it says, for any hours that the car wash is open. So they couldn't be open 24 hours unless there was an attendant. And there's no way for the zoning board to give them relief from that because it's part of the definition. Mm-hmm. So it creates that as part of the use.
Under the 24 hours, there has to be an attendant present?
Under any car wash. It doesn't matter.
Under any car wash, really.
So it looks like we're changing that, though. In the
We are. I mean,
but it doesn't help them now.
It doesn't help them now. And, you know, I don't know that it's a critical issue for them. If it changes, they're not required to continue having an attendant. But this definition was written before that even came to light as part of their proposal. So if there are things that you feel are prudent or important to be included as part of a definition, after reading through those, perhaps we should have a final discussion about what that means and how they fit together. But I just want to put the caution out there for the implications of what that means going forward for uses.
Do you feel we've, because I know they were combining the uses and under the definition, the current definition of a shopping center.
Yeah.
Have we addressed that really? Because it just seems, because in our new definition, it says three or more.
I think the current building inspector said he doesn't think that that's necessary because we don't have anything that prohibits multiple commercial uses if they're mm-hmm. by special permit. I thought we had, I don't know that we have addressed that, but it's certainly something we can look at.
At times when people apply to the ZBA, like with the private club, or it just seems like they're picking the definitions the closest to what they want, but it mm-hmm. doesn't really encompass what they're doing, you know. Or,
and it does say a single piece of real estate containing more than three commercial establishments and a total business space of more than 5,000 square feet,
okay.
planned, constructed, and managed as a total entity with consumer and employee parking provided on site.
Okay.
We decided to keep the existing bed and breakfast, right?
Yes.
Definition.
For the next meeting, I should have the grid put together with my recommendations on what would fit where to start that conversation.
Okay.
I think that'll go a little bit quicker than us sitting down with a blank grid and trying to hammer out where stuff should go. Although that might be fun.
We'll let Dave handle the way the commercial solar goes.
Anywhere on West Street.
Yeah, I mean.
Funny.
I thought we
should come over and camp out in the Pleasant Street one with me. It's real pretty.
Do we have anything else?
I don't know. Is there any further discussion on the use table? Definitions and use. Well, definitions and use table next meeting.
Not for me.
It's good.
All right. Complete streets and 40B update are still on our pending items.
They are. I have a meeting this week with the town manager and the DPW director on the complete streets draft. So I'll send that along to you folks to have a look at, but I expect it'll be pretty low-key. And then we can make our address after that, and 40B I'm still picking away at.
Yeah, on that, I just did get the 40B handbook. I think they're putting it online. So
yeah, actually, a friend of mine handed me one. He said, oh, I grabbed three of them, take one.
Yeah, I grabbed an extra for the chair if he wants it, but I know that...
Excellent, thank you.
If we come across it, could we distribute it to the board so
sure.
that we know? And then as far as the update, are we going to be able to track that? I think it's something we need to...
Track keep. What?
Oh.
SHI?
Well, just where we're at every year. Are we going to
get
an
update
annual
every year
update?
From the state.
But no, as far as our safe harbor.
I until we're producing units annually, we're not going to be producing units. So what it's based on, when units get approved and how many units were approved.
Mm-hmm.
And where Whalum was a modification, I think only a small portion of the units count. And I don't know if it meets the 0.5%. And Hollis Hills, I'm working with them to figure out if the amount of time that it was in court takes it off the books, and then the court judgment puts it back on the books.
Okay. But it'll be clear how far out of safe harbor we'll be from your report? Or?
Yeah, oh, yeah, yeah. Because, I mean, once we hit 10%, that's permanent safe harbor, and then the HPP allows for temporary
mm-hmm.
for fixed periods of time.
We're not close to 10, right?
If Hollis and Whalum both get built and Tri-Town gets built out, we hit 10.
Should we
HPP?
Are we going to consider changing the numbers so that we can stay ahead of it a little bit better? Like the little developments.
Oh, the...
don't count.
The inclusionary.
Know. Yeah. So, I mean, if we bump that up to 12% or something, you know what I mean?
Yeah, well...
You'll make up for that, hopefully, in the long run. Keep us ahead of it.
In theory, we could try something like that.
Yeah.
Right, because that was their suggestion, that you should shoot for 10, or actually probably shoot for more, like mm-hmm. 12.
Because you're going to get nickel and dimed on A&R lots. And,
right, and
because
it's over 5 years, you know, 20, 30 units a year isn't going to make a difference, but over the course of 5 years, it'll mm-hmm. cheat its way up there, and there's not really anything you can do if there's under 10 to...
Mm-hmm.
To mitigate stop. That, yeah. And then you need a 40B.
Well, most inclusionary,
to bounce you up over
yeah,
that,
most
or
inclusionary
a huge
is
huge development. You know,
it starts at 10 units, and ours is 10% up to. I have it right here.
Yeah, I was going to ask if we have like
if
over 50 units,
and
does it go up,
and
or?
It bumps up to 15% after a certain threshold.
Oh, it does.
Okay,
I didn't know
that. All right.
Okay.
Boom. 36 or more kicks up to 15%.
Okay.
So, you know, it's the medium-sized developments hit you with the 10, and then once you get anything large-ish, you should be at 15%.
Okay.
Unless somebody does a 10-lot subdivision, then another 10-lot subdivision, then a 6-lot subdivision.
We have to cover that.
And calls it four different subdivisions.
We have to fix that in our definitions, that if there's contiguous, subdivisions, that they count as one greater subdivision.
Yeah. You can't really do that unless it's under common ownership. Good luck. You know what I mean?
Can we can't do that? It's not illegal, is it?
Well, if it's under common ownership, I suppose.
Well, if it were the same developer, right. I think we could make a case.
Yeah.
I mean, what would probably happen is it would be, you know, subdivision 1 LLC, subdivision 2 LLC, subdivision 3 LLC.
Right.
Yeah, well,
chasing them forever.
I think the way we have it written now covers it, but there's been individuals who've tried to split hairs on that one, so if we could tighten it up, that might go along.
See what we can do.
Right, I don't want to have a 40P to push us up over the 10%. You know, I prefer we do it on our own, and I guess the goal is to stay in permanent safe harbor, correct?
Yes.
So.
And they come out with that number every 10 years, right?
What number?
The number of, it's based on the, it's based on the survey.
The 10% number?
Right.
Yes, it's based on the, and I don't know if they'll start moving with the way that the national census has moved away from, it's not every 10 years for a lot of the non-population stuff. It's a rolling, it's called the American Community Survey, and they do a sampling of households every year, and they come up with composite numbers that bridge a 3-year period or a 5-year period, depending on the size of your community. Mm. So that number is constantly updating based on an average of 3 years, based on an extrapolated number from a targeted sample.
I could have sworn that the MGL specified based on the 10-year housing stock.
It may. I'd have to look back at it, and if it is, then they would do it every 10 years. But
and there are other areas of safe harbor other than the 10%. It states here a 1.5% general land area rule.
Call Newton.
Huh?
They've been fighting with the state for a decade about the land area. It's very, very difficult to prove.
That's what she said. Yeah.
And you can't contest DCHD's interpretation of your land area use. So if they say you haven't met 1.5%, you don't really have an appeal for that.
All right. Anything else? That brings us to board comment and concerns.
Commercial solar bad. No.
All right, Frankenstein.
I do. Are we going to be at the recent Board of Selectmen's meeting? There was an inquiry as to the permitting software.
Mm-hmm.
Did the town manager approach you to get our input?
We've talked somewhat about it.
Okay. Are they going to solicit our input?
Oh, are they going to solicit your input?
I thought that one of the Board of Selectmen members had inquired as to whether they would solicit our input, whether we feel it would be used by us, because...
Well, I don't know that it'll be used by you. It will be used by Marjorie and myself.
Mm-hmm.
It's more for the paperwork side of things, and it's more for record keeping and taking the applications in and potentially distributing them to you in a digital form.
Okay.
What it does is it increases internal communication between departments so that we can receive everything digitally and we don't have to go and then package stuff up and bring it here and bring it there. It automatically would distribute it based on the application to predetermined people who would have the opportunity to review it, and the application wouldn't move forward without them either saying no comment or making comments or something to that effect.
Okay. It'll basically give us better tools to
it would
expedite the process.
Yeah, okay. It would be looking to allow people to apply
from home without the need for excessive amounts of paper and all that kind of good stuff.
Okay.
Was the town manager still looking for grants for that, or is that?
Yeah. Kind of, okay.
That'd be great.
Yeah, there's a grant coming up. The IT grant, I think, closes at the end of the week, and I think she's been told that it would be a pretty good contender for that.
Good. I know at one point we kind of threw back and forth if that would be a capital planning thing in the future.
Yeah, I mean, it's upwards of $100,000 to do the implementation townwide.
And then I guess my other question is, any word on the letter from the building inspector regarding 9 Mass Ave, or 9?
I did forward him your concerns, and I did forward him a letter that I sent to their property manager regarding that they shouldn't be parking there.
Okay. And then also, a resident approached me regarding some issues with a stormwater permit on Reservoir Road. Have you had any information?
I've spoken to the abutter several times. I know that the conservation agent has been over there multiple times, and they have the construction entrances in place, and they have been using them the times that he's been over there, and he hasn't observed any silt on the road.
Mm-hmm.
I know she has some issues with water coming onto her property from the road in general. She hasn't made any formal complaints outside of it's probably been a month or more since I last heard from her, and it was about them accessing the site, not over the construction entrance.
Mm-hmm.
Myself and the conservation agent both contacted the property owner and said, hey, you know, this says you have to do it, you have to do it, you have to start doing it, or, you know, we have to take action to enforce it. And my understanding is he's been using it since then, and she has not contacted me to say that he hasn't.
Meaning he switched to do what was...
He had the stone aprons in place,
mm-hmm.
and he was just pulling... His contractors were pulling into the lot because it was snowy, and they just... I decided that they didn't either want to look for it or use it.
Okay.
But he has been informed, and like I said, I have not heard from her since, it's probably been since early January.
Okay, yeah, I just, because she did participate in the CONSCOM process and through our process, and we did tell her that if she did have an issue, this would be the appropriate place to address
it. Yeah, and I mean, we have...
We're following up and making sure that her issues are at least being fielded.
She also came to a stormwater task force meeting.
Yes.
All right, that's all I got. Thank you.
All right. Well, that's it.
Motion to adjourn.
Second.
Any discussion? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Aye. Excellent.